Good morning. We are calling to order the County Commissioners meeting, which was canceled during the snowstorm, so we're doing two this week. Today is February 3rd. Today is February 3rd. So with that, we all stand for a pledge of allegiance, please. I pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America and to the republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all. And may we have a moment of silence to remember our troops and those who serve us and keep us safe.
Madam Chairman, may I add a thought I just got an email from a gentleman by the name of Paul LaBelle. He was a longtime Barnstable County Assembly of Delegates. I guess he passed away. So I'd like to add him in our thoughts. And also from the town of Howard, Sheldon Thayer, longtime participant in town government. Mm-hmm. So I'd like to add him in our thoughts also.
Him and their
families.
Families. Yes.
Thank you.
Thank you. Okay, good morning. Well, first on our agenda is the dredge. How is the dredge?
The dredge is busy.
Could you come up and introduce yourself, please? Great.
I'm Wayne Jetke and represent the County of Barnstable, the dredge program. And this year we've had a busy year. We have 14 projects to do, and we've done half of them. We're on our seventh project now. So. It should carry us through the fiscal year, or probably to middle of June we should finish up. So it's a busy year.
Yeah.
Yeah. And next year looks to be a little bit busier. So it's.
How's the codfish?
The codfish is we replaced the pump last year, and now it's got some bearing issues for the main bearing. It's getting old. It's going on 20 years now, and that's about the life expectancy of a dredge.
So. Right. So we have to look at that. I know that we looked at it last year, and we didn't.
Through the Dredge Advisory Committee, we ended up that we decided that they voted on it, and they agreed to raise the rates by $2 per cubic yard, and put the money towards the replacement or a new dredge, and so that's. That's on the
it's building up.
Mission statement. Yeah.
Okay,
so.
Good.
So last year's request for bond revenues, the $2 million, that was my recollection was to buy the new dredge.
Yes.
We never did that.
We never, no.
Okay.
How is it? Do you do tour?
Yes.
Has anybody been down there?
It's.
With this, have you been down there since the storms?
We not on the East Coast. We've down the harbor.
Right.
And then if you take a look at Corn Hill and the beaches going to the north, you're going to find that those beaches are in great shape, you know. Mm-hmm. And the dune system is very healthy.
Mm-hmm.
And then you go on the other side and you can see what's going on.
Right. I was down at Newcomb Hollow, and you know, I go along the beach road. So, and I take these pictures. I got to start putting them side by side because you could actually see erosion over years, I think, but it was totally wiped out at Nauset. I mean, at Newcomb Hall. I mean, you know, you have the built-up sand that you can walk down. Nothing. It was like a sheer cliff.
Yeah. Is that house still standing? Or the
yeah, I couldn't really standing? See. I was afraid to go out on the ledge because it was very precarious. Mm. So I couldn't really kind of lean over, and I couldn't get down onto the thing to see what was going on up there. But
because the DPW, they closed it up a year ago.
Yeah, there's a few of them. There's a few of them on the ledge there that are.
Yeah. Wow. They call it could be another canal.
Well, there is a break there in the middle. So, and once that breaks, you know, it starts to make I said, you know, I kept saying 30 years I'll have waterfront property. It might be 20. Great, we're going. Okay, with that, do you have any questions?
I have a lot of questions.
Go for it, Leo.
Let's go for revenue first, and let's go for this 15 years budget we're in. Okay, just so you understand where my questions are.
Right.
Projected a proposed income of just over $1 million, $1,028,000. It appears that as of December, we've only taken in about $300,000, leaving a remaining of over $700,000 still to come in. Do you feel confident that the FY15's budget is going to bring in the revenues that we projected, the million, or are we?
The
Is there any issues on income?
The income for the year in 2015,
I know we increased it about 10% from the previous year. We had about 900,000 approved in 14, and we went up to 1,028,000 in 15.
I anticipate the revenues to come in. I got my sheet.
I know we have a certain problem with the fiscal year and fiscal year ending, so we have to kind of do a little bit of a dance with encumbered revenues, projected revenues too, because we know that although we allocated them from 15, but if we actually do the job late in the year, it may roll over into next year's, but in our minds, we have to kind of allocate it for this year because it's all budgeting, I guess.
As it stands right now, that I would say that it'll probably be a little lower than that income due to the problems we've been having for dredge time, running time due to the weather that we've had. And I know that we passed up one of the projects earlier. It was a project in Marshfield that came to be a problem. And so we passed on that. So that would have been part of that revenue of $1,028,000.
Okay.
So but then our costs will actually be lower also.
Right. Yeah, respectively. But yeah. To a proportion anyhow, because of labor and moving the dredge and all that.
Definitely, and that was a difficult project.
Right. So. Do you think that might come back for next year, or do we lose that project?
There was some issues with the way the charter's written, the Barnstable charter, and doing the work, and you had to go through the county and the towns were not working together up there, and it got to be, we started, approaching council about it, and right. I just thought it's just something I don't want to get into. I don't have the time for it, and it's hard to get to, so, and they've taken a major hit, this winter. So.
Now, your projected expenses are up quite a bit, so now we're going to jump into 16.
Okay.
Your expected expenses projected into 16 are up almost $670,000.
Mm-hmm.
Majority, a good portion of that is dredge salaries. It's going from 288 up to 433. Do you want to address that particular one?
Mm-hmm. As far as the labor is, I was planning on adding two people to the crew to accommodate for the extra running time that we're probably going to need to do the 150,000 cubic yards of material to dredge.
So this would be two full-time positions?
Yes.
And do you expect that the revenue that you're going to get in from adding those people will cover the cost of that?
Yes.
Okay. And when you hire people, are they full-time employees, or do you only take them out when you take the dredge out? Because I know a lot of times the dredge doesn't work, but then again, you have a lot of other things that you're doing too, just so the public understands when we talk about hiring a full-time person, you have the physical dredge may only be pumping for X amount of days, and that's what they see, I mean, there's moving it, there's cleaning it, there's preparing it, and these people pretty much stay on board full-time, right?
Yes, yeah. Besides myself, we have three people, a captain, Lieberman, and a deckhand. And we do just about all of our own repairs to the dredge. And so, like, if we're not dredging, we're making money because we charge by cubic yard.
Right.
It ends up then we're doing repairs, And with dredging on the Cape, it ends up it's sand. 99% of our work is sand. And sand is very abrasive, and it's hard on the equipment. The saltwater environment's hard on the equipment, so that's... That requires a lot of maintenance, so that's about a lot of what the crew does when we're not dredging. In reference to the revenue, I expect the revenue up by over 50%, or like 153% of what we're doing this year. So, and that's with the.
Can you give me an idea what that the revenue that we, I'm not gonna say we lost it, but the job that we decided not to do in Marshfield, are you looking at a couple hundred grand, 500 grand, 200 grand?
250,000.
250? So we take that right off, because we didn't get it. And then you're expected, so if we take the, I'm sorry, the, what I can do here, let's call it $1 million, so we made, or we're projecting to make around 750, and you're saying if you take the 750 and you add about how much to it, that you're projecting in 16?
The, actually, it's about 1.7 million.
Really? With just a single dredge too, we're not running two dredges yet.
No, what, the size of the project is actually gonna increase, we're picking up two projects that are, well, one of them's 42,000 cubic yards, it's gonna be on Samson's Island.
Oh.
And pumping the length down to Dead Neck, and so actually our moving time between projects is gonna be reduced, so our time, our running time is gonna be higher. And then Bass River, we're doing a total of 29,000 cubic yards on Bass River, which is all protected work, and so our running time should be high there also. On the average, we probably do 5,000 cubic yards per project, so that means like every 2 weeks we're moving between projects. And if you get into weather delays or something like that, you know.
Plus, there's also certain times of year that you can dredge or not, right, because of shell fishing.
Yeah, on the south side, it's flounder, and then you get into plovers, and so there's a lot of issues with it.
Do you find it out? I noticed it. Do you mind if I keep going?
Go right ahead.
Dredge repair costs are going from 35,000 up to 60. Are we looking at repairing this continually, or are we gonna maybe bite the bullet and get a new one, or what? Are there any plans or discussion on that?
Yes. Well, with the increase in revenue, we should be able to definitely afford a new dredge. Mm. So, and since it is a price per cubic yard, you know, whether it's booster work or regular work, we're gonna gain $2 per cubic yard to put towards an interest.
So Bob, do you have any idea what we have in the account now as far as in the, because this is a...
it's an enterprise fund.
Enterprise fund,
which
right.
is good. No, off the top of my head, I don't know how much, but the good news is it stays there, and by law, Wayne cannot spend more than he takes in.
Right.
So his is like self-balancing.
Right.
But the other income would then be appropriated in some future year to cover the cost of principal and interest payments.
What's the difference between dredge repairs at 60,000, what you're requesting, up almost 30 grand, as to dredge equipment maintenance, which was 20, and that's up 45,000? I mean, both those line items together are almost up $50,000.
The dredge, it ends up, what we're gonna be doing with the dredge is it's gotta have the bearing assembly, the thrust bearing assembly is gonna have to be changed out, and that's gonna be probably all of $5,000. And then the superstructure on the dredge is pretty well rotten now, and that has to be replaced, and that's gonna be closer to $30,000. So that's the increase in the revenues. As far as the support equipment to do that, the booster pump is gonna need some repairs this summer, and so that'd be the other equipment that you're making reference to.
So Wayne, with those repairs and that equipment being replaced, that would stretch the life out of the dredge for probably like another year, maybe two, until we can build up those coffers.
Probably more like 3 or 4 years.
Really?
So yeah.
So then that way you'd have a good base. We could go for a bond and have it half done.
Yeah, especially if you go 3 or 4 years, you know.
If all
stays well.
If we're
doing like 100,000 yards a year, that's, you know, $200,000 towards the dredge.
That's great.
Miscellaneous contractual services, going from 7,000 up to 32?
Yeah, some of the projects that we're gonna be doing, like on Bass River and in Kotua Bay, there's gonna be subcontractor work to do the upland work. It's confined disposal areas.
So you pass that on to the...
Through the project,
through the route project.
And how much savings, even with all of, you know, you're going to add a little bit of cost to it and that sort of thing, you're still saving the towns huge that employ it.
Yeah, as the towns are finding that they're buying sand for $17 per cubic yard. And then you get the dozer working for the placement of the material. Mm-hmm. So it's high. So here they get the dredging done and they get a recharge.
Right.
Is your fuel cost just a direct relation to the amount of jobs that you're planning on doing and running time?
That was due to the yardage that we're going, so.
The only other big one that I had, well, there's a couple other ones, but then I figured I might as well hit them all since you're here. Miscellaneous supplies and mats are going up 20 grand? From 40,000 to 60,000?
Which one was that?
5399.
5399, yes.
Dredge miscellaneous supplies, and it says mats.
Materials.
Okay.
So, materials that, as the dredge gets older, and like I say, it's in need of some repair, that, you know, replacement parts are definitely gonna go up. So that's up by $20,000, plus the increased yardage, so your costs go up, you know?
Yeah.
Like I say, it doesn't.
I'm just not sure if it's not prudent to maybe, I don't, you have a committee that decides, makes the decision when it's time to get a new dredge or not? Did you mention something?
Dredge advisory committee, yeah, and what they ended up doing, we've been talking about it for years, and it ends up the dredge advisory committee said, oh, instead of us paying for it, the towns, you know, like increased costs and that, they wanted us to go out and try and get a grant from like the Seaport Advisory Council. And then they had other ones where, you know, the towns sharing services, you know, they came up with some money. And so we pursued it, and it ends up, we never were able to come up with any of it. And so this last meeting that we had, I said, listen, if you wanna put together a meeting, you know, a board to go through and try and pursue grants, you know, let's elect people to do it, but I don't have the time to do it. And so what we proposed was raising the rates by $2 per cubic yard and put that towards the funding of a dredge. And they agreed to it, so.
Yeah, I understand this is all just budgeted and stuff like that, but again, you know, just conversation purposes, you've got three line items which are kinda directly related to each other in regards to miscellaneous equipment repairs and pipe repair and miscellaneous supplies and materials. And you know, you're up almost 70 grand if you add the three of those together. I don't know if that's the kind of thing that the dredge committee looks at and says, you know, maybe it's time to move sooner than later. Again, I support this, because again, it's a revenue-based thing. But it just, I'm also a big one, as you know, I think it, you know, we should look at not only having maybe two, a smaller one, not two big ones, because I don't support that from what I've heard, but certainly maybe picking up something to do the smaller jobs. Especially now we are looking to increase some labor too, you know, that might be something in the horizon that you might wanna look at.
As far as 5399, that is more like operating materials, you know, whether it's wipey dipes or oil or, you know, like parts, you know, because you're always replacing parts. That's our operational line item. And then the repairs gets into like, if you go into a shipyard or something like that, you can get into shipyard work for the repairs of equipment.
How about the great big one now? Let's go to the elephant in the room. You're going from the dredge reserve from 75,000 to 317.5.
Well, that's the anticipated $2 per cubic yard on 150,000 yards.
So that's strictly based on the anticipated
income.
Raise in the, in your cost.
In the yardage.
In the raise in yardage.
Yeah, so.
I'm sorry, just to clarify it again in my head, is that based on, because in 16, you're planning on doing a lot more yardage, or it's based on the fact that you're charging now $2 more a yard, or you mentioned a figure?
Or
both?
It's both.
Okay.
But it is an increase in yardage by 50, you know, 150%.
I think I'm done. I'd like to see, like I said, I really want to keep the discussions and negotiations and information open about not only replacing it, but I know there was some talk a while back about buying a smaller one that could be towed with a smaller dump truck type situation over the road to be able to do smaller inlets and estuaries, maybe even freshwater ponds.
I would go something truckable, but not too small, because anybody with a really small dredge wants a bigger dredge.
Right. Well, certainly it would come from, you know, the request would come from you and your department, but I know it's a discussion that we had a couple of years ago, and it kind of, it seemed to get a lot of support, but it just never went anywhere, so.
We had a project in Barnstable that was actually gonna come up, Mill Pond down on 149 and 28. And that was, it seemed like it was good to go. And I was working on acquiring a smaller dredge, it was a 370.
Yeah.
And something that one crane could pick it up and set it in the pond, you know, and you could truck it on one flatbed along the way. And I don't know, the project was funded, and then it sort of fell apart. I don't know, something with water quality or water collaborative or something there.
Okay.
Do you know what they do in the Bass River, way up? Because you only do the mouth.
The
But way up in there, do they do any dredging?
When you're talking about above Upper County Road?
Well, yeah, even even the Bass River Bridge on 28 in that section in between the two, and then it goes all the way up into
Fallen's Pond.
Fallen's Pond, yeah. We've never really sent the dredge all the way up in there, right?
No, it that'd be one where if you had a truckable dredge, right, you could truck it in there and then launch it off of.
Take it into the bridge.
Yeah. Yeah, you have the bridge at Upper County, which is a timber piled bridge, and then you have a low bridge.
Well, the bridge at Route 6 is a timber bridge too, isn't it? Underneath, I think it is.
Yeah.
It used to be.
You think of the railroad bridge.
Yeah, no, I think the railroad bridge is gone now.
Right.
They took that out.
Yeah.
But the one with the drive over, that's an old, I'm pretty sure it is.
Could be.
The highway bridge.
Yeah, I think it is.
They could definitely use some dredging up there.
Yeah.
So.
Yeah.
But no, we're planning on going north of 28. We're not going, I don't know if you know where the golf course is and that.
Yeah.
About the upper limits of what they permitted.
Yeah.
Okay.
So these, the new hires won't be put on until 16?
No.
The new budget coming in. And you're basically increasing your staff from 3 to 5?
Yes.
Okay, because you mentioned earlier you had 3 employees now, and yourself and 2 others, and then you're gonna go to 5. And you feel comfortable with that, that be able to keep the 5 full-time employees with revenue coming in, or is this something that, if it doesn't work out, we can let people go to, or we don't wanna do that, but, yeah.
Yeah, if the work's there, then we'll keep them on. If it's not.
Yeah.
It's all revenue generated, so.
Yeah.
Whatever our income is.
Well, it sounds good.
Yeah, it sounds like you're gonna have a pretty busy year. I hope we're not thinking too much, because you kind of surprised me with the $1.7 million projected revenue, so. You know.
Let's hope that all comes to fruition.
Well, hope the old girl stays running.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Yeah, I know, exactly. All right, Wayne, thank you.
All right.
As always.
Yeah, thanks, Wayne, appreciate it.
I do appreciate it. Next on our agenda is the Arts Foundation at 10:30, but we never did have public comment, and I've seen a member of the public come in. Is there, would anyone like to have public comment?
I was gonna speak to the next item on your agenda.
Which is the Arts Foundation?
Exactly.
You may do that.
The public comment, they don't wait.
You could wait till.
So no public comment.
There is no public comment on there.
Well, Madam Chairman, can I ask a question?
Yes.
The commissioner's statement, which is under public comment, is that a new, relatively new thing?
That was something I asked to be put on there earlier, as opposed to just for one particular instance. So that can be taken off. That was a one-time request on my part, and it now is part of the thing. So we can put that back down at the end, because in the end it was basically reports from commissioners and what you've been doing and what did you see out there. And
because, I mean, given the opportunity, I would love to go on record for a lot of things. So if you're going to leave that there.
Yeah.
No, I'm just
kidding. Well, you can do it at the end and wrap up your day.
Okay.
How's that?
Because I just went online, and I happened to go back to a couple of different agendas, and I noticed it wasn't there
year. Yeah, so. Well, it can be taken off at this point. It was just, it was a one-time thing. Well, while we're waiting for the Arts Foundation, I guess maybe we should wait till they're here, if you have something you'd like to.
Is that the only person coming?
Are you here to represent the Arts Foundation?
No, ma'am.
Okay.
I'm representing the EDC.
The EDC.
On that topic.
Well.
I have a handout if you'd like. I could just distribute it.
Come on up here and introduce yourself.
Good morning.
Good morning.
Felicia Penn, I'm the chair of the Cape Cod Economic Development Council. I have a handout.
It's good to see you, Felicia. I haven't seen you in a long time.
Happy New Year.
Happy New Year, all is well.
Happy belated Groundhog Day.
Yes.
May I submit?
Please.
This for you.
Thank you.
I don't even need to read it. You can read it for yourself if you prefer.
Well, actually, to be quite frank with you, if this is in relationship to the Arts Foundation's request, I would respectfully ask that we wait until they're here.
Yeah, that's fine.
I agree, but at
there's really
least
no need
we
for you to tell us something and then we'll have to fill them in. It's only four more minutes, right?
Happy
supposed
to
be here at 10:30?
Yes.
So.
Probably having a problem finding a parking spot.
Tuesday and Wednesday mornings are busy.
Is Justina wearing a coffee?
I have the wrong coffee. I just took it from Mike.
Oh.
It's very reasonable. I don't think, do I have permission statement from the...
Can I just ask a question? This correspondence isn't signed. Is there a reason for that?
More of a memo format than a letter. No, I'm happy to sign it if you'd like me to sign it.
Well, I'm kind of a stickler with things that it comes from somewhere and it's not signed. I'm not sure if someone just didn't grab a copy of your letterhead and write some thoughts down and
well,
submit them to you.
Well, my name's at the
you,
top
so.
Coming from me and I'm happy to sign it for you if you'd like. I can attest in public. I wrote it. Okay.
That's what I would suggest you to do when
okay.
we open this when we
okay.
open the discussion.
Happy to.
And this basically reflects the mood of the board.
It doesn't say
the
that.
The grant committee.
Yeah, the grant committee.
The grants so. Committee, and actually the entire, you know, informally we've had discussions as part of our total grant discussions on that, but it's been a long-held position. Just never had the impetus to come forward, I guess. I noticed on the submission from the AFCC that there is no budget attached to this, which
yes.
is kind of strange, but I'll hold my comments. I really only plan to read the letter, so I don't even need to be here. You guys have it. You know, if you have other questions, I'll wait, you know, obviously, but pardon me. Left eye is
yeah, you need
dripping
one of these.
Today. For some, is that what I need? And it was dripping in.
Do they normally show up?
They do.
Okay. Put my sunglasses on.
We can
thing,
take
so
a
I
recess
know.
For a couple of minutes until they get here.
Do you want me to wait and defer until they get here and then come
I think it'll probably be good now that we
okay.
have your letter. We
that's
can.
How much time do you usually give them? I don't know. It's
whatever they do.
10:30.
Yeah.
I'll tell you what, we have a 5-minute recess, so
we
I
can
go
have
a little boys' room.
Recess.
I want a little
thank
boys'
you.
Room.
How about that? All right, well, we are returning from recess, and we are now going to review the Arts Foundation budget. So,
okay,
would you
great.
Like to
sure.
come before us and
yep.
introduce yourself?
I brought you some of our programs
very
and material from
yeah.
the year.
Bribes?
It's
over $25.
I wish no, it's not a swag bag.
It's over $25, I can't accept it.
Yes, I know.
No, it's very valuable, but not in that sense.
Okay.
And just to introduce myself, I'm David Kaplan, the interim executive director of the Arts Foundation of Cape Cod. Kevin Howard, who you all knew, has gone on to the Cape Cod Healthcare.
Yes.
Where he's doing major fundraising.
And you're just the interim? Are you planning on?
I am just the interim. I did not apply for the permanent position. There's a search committee going on now, and hopefully within a month or two, we'll have somebody new. But I'm also, I actually came out of commercial real estate, but I'm also the executive director of the Cape and Islands Theater Coalition.
Mm-hmm.
That's more of a part-time job, but I was very familiar with the Arts Foundation through that and was on the board of directors of the Arts Foundation. So it was fairly easy for me to step in. They didn't really want to miss a beat. They wanted to keep all the programs going. Fortunately, this is enough time before POPs that it wasn't crucial to have a permanent director in yet.
Mm-hmm.
But I think that, again, that will happen
soon.
And I think, from my understanding, there have been a lot of terrific candidates. So I'm optimistic. I am feeling a little sad now that I'll be leaving. Because it's been very interesting, very fun, to be honest. So, yeah.
Well, you can always put your name in.
Well, yeah. And they might not let
maybe
me.
Maybe not too late.
And I put together a PowerPoint, which I printed out for people.
Thank you.
Just to go over.
Since we're not in the smart room.
Yeah.
Thank you.
We'll go one more if anyone wants it. And then I assume you also have our letter.
Yes, that you sent to Mark.
Yeah, which really delineated what we had done over the past year and what we want to do in the future, what we're working on now. But I think if we just work through the PowerPoint so you can understand a little bit more about what we're doing. Obviously, we're very, very grateful to the county for their past support, and we hope that can continue. We're just in the midst of our annual winter art exhibit, and that's this year called Opposites Attract. That's at Kituate going on now. If you have a chance to see it, it's really terrific. And the point of that exhibit is it supports the artists, but it's also directed towards school kids. All the art is put a foot lower than it would normally be hung.
Mm-hmm.
And we bring in probably about 2,000 students come through, have a docented tour, then do an art project. Due to the snow, it may be not quite 2,000. There'd be quite a few cancellations, but we're trying to catch up. And this year we also added trips for senior citizens, where they also get a directed tour. So yeah, so we're trying to serve more populations with that. And at the end of each program, what I did was mark for you the current funding status. So in this case, we had enough money to put it on this year, but it's not funded for the coming year. And one of our regular sponsors dropped out, which is part of what happens with us. We have sponsors coming in, sponsors going out. We're always looking for that more steady stream of income. So, and which is one of the great benefits of the county funding, is that it's much more reliable for us. Creative Community Awards, I think, Sheila, you've certainly been to those.
Mm-hmm, I have.
In fact, I think when the Theater Coalition won, you gave us our award.
Yes, I believe I did.
And that's something that the community really looks forward to, really enjoys. Again, for this coming year, it's unfunded. And unfunded usually means we're asking corporations for funding, foundations for funding, individuals for funding, but we don't always get that. It doesn't mean that we won't have the event. We still will have the event. We'll take it out of general funds. We may reduce what we contribute to other programs. And the same annual Creative Collaborative Conference, which is a great conference, has over 200 people come in the arts community. This year, actually, we decided not to hold it, partly because there was a little bit of a funding problem, but mostly because it was the first major event coming up after Kevin left. It's normally in March. So the decision was this year, we'll just bypass that, make the transition a little bit easier for anyone new who comes into the directorship. Then, as you know, one of our main missions and what we wish we could do a lot more of is just basic grant giving to artists, arts organizations around the Cape. We do have general grants where institutions apply. There's a review committee and we, you know, we assess how much we can give them and go ahead with that. Last year, as you may remember, we created something new, the Strategic Alliance Grants. Mm-hmm. We had a number of major arts organizations that every year had to come back with some project grant. And it was actually, it was taking a lot of their time to do it. So we decided, let's recognize that these are important. They have the highest attendance. They do the most for their local communities. Let's give them, just as we ask of you, let's the Arts Foundation give them a more steady stream of income. So we initiated that, and that's where they can rely, by virtue of passing certain criteria beforehand, they can rely on 2 or 3 years of steady grant making from the Arts Foundation.
Do you follow up on to make sure that they're doing what they projected they were going to do and they're credited and they
awarded
the grant?
Yeah, we do follow up. That process hasn't started yet because within a 2-year span, we'll do an on-site review. So we'll actually go there, see what they're doing, make sure they're wisely using the money. And then we also require them to be part of a state project which tracks statistics of nonprofit cultural organizations. So they have to comply with that and then we get reported back from that. So that's an MCC project.
Does that also coincide with the one before that too, just the regular partial funding grants that go out to artists and educators?
The partial funding grants, they have to give us an end of year report that they used the money, they used it for the purpose intended, and we make sure they comply with that requirement. So
that's after you give them the money though.
It is after we give them the money, yep. Some granting institutions give post-project. Most of the groups that we're working with for those grants can't really afford to do that. They need the money ahead of time or what they're trying to do won't happen. So, but we vet them, they're known, they're all 501c3s. And they're known to us and the amounts tend to be $500 to $1,000. So I guess we do a little bit go on faith that they're going to carry it out, but then we, you know, trust but verify, I guess is what.
Are any of those reoccurring?
They're not multi-year. Okay. Some of them can reapply. We try to spread it around, but to a large degree, it is based on merit. If it's a really good project or particularly a collaborative project, then we may go ahead and fund it. But those decisions are actually made by, they're not up to the foundation itself. We have a grant committee of outside people who come and go over all the grants and really decide which they think are the most worthwhile.
So at the end of year reporting, now they're gonna tell you how it went and what they did with the money. Do they say that, gee, it reached the success? I mean, you know, not everything is a success, and it's okay
right. As
long as you're learning from that venture.
Right.
So is that sort of way, like, you know, this is where it benefited me, this is where it could have been maybe better you? I mean, is that type of analysis requested at the end?
To be honest, because I haven't been there, I haven't read very many of them. Mm-hmm. I've, on the other side, written a couple. Where I said, yes, we use the money, I tried to give some measurement of what we did.
Right.
For me, it was easy because it all was measurable. So, but I would say some, because it may be a grant that just goes to bring in a musician for an event.
Right.
So we'll confirm the event happened, the musician came in. How we then measure that, it might be hard.
I get what you're saying. As far as a proposal to do a outcome.
Right, exactly.
Right.
And again, because each individual grant is not for a great amount of money.
Right.
And it may only be partially funding, maybe a small part of funding a larger project. So it is a little tricky, but in general, the answer is yes, we try and make sure. We try and go to as many events as we can and as many organizations that we funded as we can. We're out there quite a bit. I mean, I know my own schedule is pretty hectic going to various organizations.
Any other questions?
I have a ton of questions.
Go right ahead.
Okay.
Do you have a budget?
We do have a budget.
Did you submit us a copy of that budget?
I can.
Sure.
Preferably, seeing that I don't see any in the records, if you could maybe get us, you know, maybe like last year's, and then, I don't know what your fiscal years go to, but if you could get me, you know, one older one, and then maybe the current one at minimum.
Sure. We're October 1st through September.
October 1st to October?
To September.
Right, 30, yeah.
1st.
30.
Who makes up your grant committee?
It varies each time. We'll have an assortment of community leaders, business people, artists, people representing art organizations, art trustees. It really is quite diverse.
You have a set of bylaws with, you mentioned trustees, so you must operate under a set of bylaws.
Yes.
Do we have a copy of those bylaws, Mr. Brohat, in our file?
Similar in our files.
You think we have it?
Yeah.
If it's possible, maybe if you're gathering some information, you may want to include bylaws.
Sure, I can just.
Especially if you're sending it electronically, and it's not that easy, just so Mr. Brohat doesn't have to search far.
Sure.
To just, if I can just interrupt there or add to your question on the grants committee. I had been invited to a grants committee, you know, so being on the board near.
So you have a process, basically.
So there is a process.
Yes, yeah.
And it was very thorough and very interesting, quite frankly.
I just wanted, you know, make sure that you leave here today knowing a couple of things. First of all, your foundation, the Arts Foundation of Cape Cod, I could not speak better of. I think what you do is wonderful. I've personally attended a couple of things. Absolutely, my comments and my position on whether the county should be giving you $35,000 or not has nothing whatsoever to do with your organization. Please know that.
Right.
Please know that. I do, and I have had some time, a problem with the county commissioners giving out a donation within their budget every year to the Arts Foundation. You can go back and look at my tenure of 6 years on the Assembly of Delegates. I had a problem with it from year one. The way I look at it, it is a donation made by the county to a 501c3 nonprofit organization. And quite frankly, there are hundreds of them out there that are all very worthy of the county's support. And we had one come in front of us a week and a half ago looking for a donation of $35,000 or $30,000, a one-time gift to build a kitchen so they could distribute food to the needy.
Right.
Cannot say enough, and I want it clear, what these organizations, including yours, does with the money is wonderful, and I support it 100%. I do, however, have a problem with the process.
Right.
I have a problem with how the past county commissioners decided it was upon themselves to give a donation to single out one of these organizations and give a donation to it. We have on file a letter that came in today before you arrived from the Economic Development Council, which, by the way, so the public understands this, and if you're following in your budget books at home, this is not a separate line item. This is a request that is included in the county commissioner's budget. And basically, it's $35,000, and $10,000 of that in the past has come from the Cape Cod Economic Development Council, which, for those of you who don't know, is the license plate fund money. The letter that we've received from them states that they are uneasy with the fact that the past county commissioners have granted that $10,000 without your organization going through the same, I don't want to say scrutiny because that makes it sound like something bad, but the same steps that any other good organization would have to go through in order to receive grant money from them. Quite frankly, I happen to agree with them. I think that your organization should get right in line with the rest, who are all doing good, and ask for that money on your own. And I don't think it should be the purview of county commissioners to single out one. So as far as that $10,000 goes, I won't be voting to give it to you without your organization going through the same steps that other organizations have to go through in order to receive money from them. Number one. Number two, I have been telling every one of our department heads that's been coming in here that I personally think that the county is not doing that well financially. I personally think we are not in as good as a fiscal picture that the rest of everyone else believes. My personal thoughts, okay? I would love to sit down with you and go through my budget books and show you why I believe that, but I won't bore you with that today. At home, and I sit here today, and when I got elected, I said I would sit in this seat the same way I run my farm at home. We had a devastating year last year at the farm. I lost my whole crop. One of the first things to go, my donation to the company that makes my pens. Great organization. Been with them for 30 years. Every year I send them $500. They make pens with my names on them. Sorry, I have to cut back because of financial reasons. And quite frankly, I feel the same way when I sit here in front of you today. Please, if I vote not to think that we have the $25,000 to give you, it's a no reflection whatsoever of what your company is doing or what your organization is doing. It's basically a financial decision from my point.
Right.
And I find it real hard to say 25 grand to you every single year for arts when we had another equally, I don't want to single them out, but we have had an equally important situation come in front of us asking for a one-time donation to be able to feed people. I don't want to be put in that position. I don't believe the county should be giving grant money out without a process. There's no process that I think that's in place right now. You guys do it in your own organization. You told me you have a grant committee set up. You told me you have rules that you go under when people apply for your grants. You said that you do checkups and follow-ups.
Right.
The county doesn't have that in place. I do not believe the county commissioners, through their line item and their budget, should be giving grant money out. And that's just a personal opinion. And I hope you take all that with truth with you so that when it comes time that we vote the budget, I'm not sure what's going to be there for you or not, because I don't know the position of the other two commissioners.
And I think that what Leo is touching on is something that, you know, I've seen and we've seen, Pat, as well, since we've been here, is that things were, precedents were taken, you know, with the Arts Foundation and many others, and the time when I was on the assembly, right before Leo was elected, was the last round of this giving away of money. Unfortunately, back when the county actually had surplus reserves, instead of taking those reserves and investing them into the county and maybe even personnel that they needed, you know, they knew that they needed an administrator and that sort of thing. Those things weren't done. It was given back to the towns. And that was great for those one-time little Band-Aids that the towns, but it didn't have a regional impact the way it could have been if it was thoughtfully carried out. And then there's discussion, you know, in the last year, is it the appropriate role, or is it even legal for government organizations to be giving to 501c3s? I mean, I think that there's a question if that's a, right, Bob?
Mm-hmm.
Yeah. So that's another thing that we have to look at. I mean, are we doing what we're able to do? All of this doesn't sound great for you with coming forward, I know. But these are questions that we have to look at. And Leo is right. Even if we do break with the numbers that have been projected, we got a lot of things to take care of that we don't have right now in the next few years, these extras we can be thinking of. We got to be honing in and taking care of our internal obligations to the courts and everything else. So it's a tough year all around. So having said that, I have to, you know, Leo isn't totally wrong in his thinking about the government giving, you know, money to certain grant, and it does put us in this judgment. You know, they're all, nonprofits usually serve very needy and worthy causes, whatever they may be. And so it's hard to pick and choose. And this is the year that we got to start thinking about these things and really pulling ourselves and making ourselves more professional, which is what we had to do. So with that, it's going to be a tough year. and but I'm not saying it's a dire year. But I am also have to take into consideration the EDC's request, and they are actually sort of on the same tread, and it's a legitimate one.
Right.
So we have to have that conversation when we're finalizing all these numbers and budget and what our priorities are going to be. So with that, we thank you for this,
can
and
I
we'll definitely seriously consider it and do what we can. But
yep. Madam Chair, I don't know when I was absent if the gentleman received a copy of this letter from Ms. Penn, who's the chair of the Cape Cod Economic Development,
no,
but I think you should leave here today with
there's
a copy of it.
Okay. Felicia
great.
Has an extra one for
so
you, so you can see.
Can I just say, respond briefly? I mean, any criteria the county wants to impose, we're happy to go along with.
Mm-hmm.
As much scrutiny as you want, we're happy to give you reports, because the money really is going to good purposes. We have an audit every year, et cetera. So we're more than happy to share that. We're more than happy to work with you in setting up any criteria. And the other thing I would just say is that unlike individual 501c3s coming to you, we are an umbrella organization. Our mission is to, whatever funds we get, feed that back to the broader community,
mm-hmm.
particularly on the economic side. So I think it is a bit more of a distinction in that sense. And certainly there are other municipalities and state governments and federal government where we would be an actual government agency. It happens that on Cape Cod it doesn't work that way, but we still look for help
mm-hmm.
from the government.
Mm-hmm.
The money that we get from the commission, from the county, is at this point probably about 3.5 or 4% of our budget, but it's a very, very important 3.5 or 4%. And again, we're feeding that all back to the artists, the organizations, building the cultural economy of the Cape, and we think that's important, and we really are the only group that does that.
Mm-hmm.
And the cultural economy is probably, the latest statistics were, I think, about 10% of the economy of the Cape.
No, it is. It's very important, and I think that the work that you do with the schools, because that's something that's always, you know, everybody wants to cut, and unfortunately these are the things that are cut, and that's what we're looking at even here. But, you know, those are very necessary things, and, you know, I definitely support them, and I remember always enjoying them when they were provided for me at school. And so I definitely support the efforts, and I understand that it has a regional reach. It's not just a Hyannis-centric or Barnstable-centric, it is a Barnstable County, so which
right.
is what I'm sure lent the commissioners in coming to adopt this, but
right.
we really do have to look at our legal obligations and the form of how we're doing this and see what we can come up with.
Totally understand if we can be part of that conversation.
Definitely, we
great.
Will call you in if we're trying to hammer it out and how does this sound and what can we do here.
Okay, if
we
I give you any other information immediately, I'd be happy to do so.
We will do that. So I think just you wanted a copy of the budget, so if you could just send that forward, that would be great.
Yeah, we'll get you that. We'll get you the bylaws.
Yeah,
sure.
And then if we have other questions, we'll call you back in.
Okay. Yeah.
And we want to have a discussion about it.
Because we are a total open book in everything
okay.
that we do. So.
All right.
Good. Thank you very much.
Great. Thank you. I appreciate it.
Are we going to have a continued discussion on the commissioner's budget, or is this something that's going to come up again? Because this discussion for the economic development, I mean the Arts Foundation, is under the commissioner's
yes,
budget.
Yes, it is under the commissioner's
budget.
So are
budget. We going to discuss the commissioner's budget, or are you going to bring that up at a later date?
John, and I'll be back here.
Okay. Thank you. If we need you, we'll grab you.
Yep.
Okay. All right.
The commissioner's budget is on today's agenda.
Is on today's
oh, okay.
agenda. So
yeah.
we can, you know, go
good.
Over that, but we can revisit it.
Well, just to get into the commissioner's budget a little bit, I see that there's under the new initiative request form, there's $100,000 earmarked under contractual services, and there's a little bit of an update, a little bit of an explanation on that. It's the campus master plan to help fund that. If you could bring back to Bob, because Bob had to leave, I understand that the building maintenance may also be looking at maybe setting aside some funds in there, and I don't want to double dip, number one. I want to make sure it's just in one place. Where it is, I don't particularly care.
Mm-hmm.
I don't know, Madam Chair, if you
that.
Have an opinion on where it is. The only other thing I would request that it be at minimum of $250,000. Personally, I don't think $100,000 when we're thinking about doing possibly going at reconstruction and some really in-depth development. And again, this is just budgeting the money. This is about, and I did the people at home to hear this. Just because we have it in the budget doesn't mean we're gonna spend it.
Right, yes.
But to only have 100 grand, to be quite frank, I don't think 100 grand's gonna address anything. So I would like to see that figure at least at 250. So in the event we go to the next stage, which says we have to go out for RFQs or RFPs to hire a an architectural firm to maybe bring some documents to the table that we then can go out to bid on.
Yes.
I think a minimum of 250 is really the amount that we should be requesting.
And I agree. So, I agree with Leo on that, because there was a conversation we had with an architect, I believe, and in asking, you know, what are the price ranges of him doing sort of a thumbnail outline, or you really want to do a very detailed, how many people are going to live in these buildings? You know, what's the staff requirement? What's the space requirement? What's the building? Are the buildings able to be renovated, or is it better to tear them down? Have that assessment done. What's the balance? You know, what's the pros and cons of each approach? And if I remember right, to do that type of analysis, I think he said something around 170,000. So it is much closer into the ballpark of what Leo is saying, and I'd rather have extra money that we don't use there for that purpose as opposed to not having it at all.
Okay.
So I agree with that.
Now, in this revised document that you just sent out, I see it struck out, so it must be in facilities then?
Yes, sir. Madam Chair, Commissioner, Bob and I have talked about this, and we've decided to make some adjustments in the commissioner's budget spreadsheet. We have taken it out of the commissioner's office budget for $100,000, and instead we've put it in the capital improvement program under facilities.
Okay.
And we put in actually $200,000.
Mm-hmm.
And what that would do, that those funds could be used for a combination of planning, design, architectural fees, and we could also use this to do some design build, some engineering. So it's a combination of things.
Right.
And we felt that it would be better to take it out of the commissioner's office operational budget,
mm-hmm,
and put it in the capital budget.
Right.
So we have revised the commissioner's office budget as shown on the revised sheet.
I see that. And one thing that's not in here, and I do want, I guess professional technical services, how would this be under? Some sort of educational fee, if somebody wants, if there's a conference, a seminar that we should go to, there are a lot of things being offered, and it's, we deserve board development work as well as our staff needing professional staff development.
Yes.
And I think that when those opportunities arise, that we should have the money in there that we can take advantage of it just for our own function, and so that we can be even better at what we're doing and up to date with what we should be doing.
Okay.
So I'd like to put in some kind of money there.
So you're talking about the out-of-state travel then, or professional technical services?
I guess professional technical services. So professional, like education or ongoing.
There's already $55,000 in there. What are we appropriating that for now?
That professional technical services are a combination of things. If we need to go out and do a survey of a county property, if we need to do an appraisal or an evaluation of something that facilities doesn't have in their budget, it's a way for us to use it for direct professional technical. We've used it in the past on hiring an architect to design something. We've hired him as an engineer to do an assessment and appraisal of a particular piece of property. All of the county's properties haven't been updated as far as the surveys for a number of years, and so from a legal point of view, we're in the process of doing that. So that professional and technical is a combination of things that as problems arise, we have the ability to take on those projects.
Is there enough money, is 55 enough, so say if there was going to be a, you know, a large survey? You know, we recently had to come up with $30,000 to start a process of water survey. You know, if we that would have been taken out of that line item?
It would have been, yes.
So, if...
What kind of figures are you thinking about as far as to cover your needs? I mean, $5,000 more, or...
Yeah, I mean, I was just thinking if we had educational things...
That there would be a $5,000...
Five or ten, yeah.
Buffer in there, isn't there, at the 5,500, or do you think we should increase that to 60,000? I mean, it sounds like over the course of the year that we probably won't spend the 55,000 anyhow.
Right.
And I'm sure there's probably $5,000 in there, I'm not sure, but I would like to know, I believe that there is 5,000, which would cover your needs.
Right.
So, I guess the question is if you would want to see that raised to 60,000 or not.
To 60, yeah, let's just do that to 60, just to make sure, because there are going to be different things coming up, and...
And I'm glad that we see that in this line item as opposed to spreading it out through the other budgets and other department heads.
Right.
Because I think it's something, I believe, and as I was on record earlier saying, that we get a bang for our buck if we do kind of a seminar thing where people come to here and we bring someone here to speak to them.
Right.
As opposed to paying for Leo to go to here or
right.
there
and
things
and
like
the,
that.
The different law firms that we've been talking to,
right.
and I'm sure
so.
You talked to several, they're all of that is offered as part of their
right.
their thing, so we can take advantage of those services as well. But those are exactly the types of things that we need to have come down, and you know, if we wanted to do a retreat together and have somebody facilitate that, that's some money there for that.
Okay. So that I'll increase the professional technical by 5, but you can use that for educational expenses.
Okay, great.
And I think that's probably a good idea, only because you had mentioned surveys and property surveys and things like that.
Mm-hmm.
And we may see a little bit of this 55 eaten up in 2016 with our campus review too.
Exactly.
So it's kind of a good idea to put a little bit of a buffer in there.
I think
where
so.
In the past it may not have been eaten up, but I think we're gonna see some, maybe some needs for some surveys, especially back property lines and stuff like that.
Exactly.
We're talking about doing some increasing the building sizes or whatever. So yeah, I don't have a problem with that.
Okay. Anything else?
I think everything else is pretty much level, right?
Okay.
What I've done on that spreadsheet, just at the very bottom, I've highlighted in yellow.
Mm-hmm.
Actually, the one above it, with the group insurance from 46 to 51, that's based upon the 10% increase. The retirement goes from 16,470 to 18.
Mm-hmm.
So that's a slight increase. So we have had a little bit of increase, but we've also reduced a little bit in salaries and in Medicare commitments. So overall, I think that with this revision, we'll be just slightly less than the original appropriation of this fiscal year.
And then when we have the discussions, Madam Chair, about appointing our new administrator, because I'm sure we're gonna have to have quite a few discussions between now
mm-hmm.
and a finalizing of the budget. We only have appropriated in there 150 for that position at this time, and I guess that's some discussion that we're probably going to have, if that's
right.
adequate enough, or if that's...
Exactly.
So, but we get some time if we have to revisit
we
that.
We do, and that is definitely a conversation we have to have.
Madam Chair, Commissioner, just to back up on that question, the discussion will come about, but there is some safeguard in that. In our shared cost, we also have a line item, but when there are changes to
right.
personnel, any change to the new county administrator salary can also be picked up within that line item. So we are covering
right.
that.
But I'm hoping we have that discussion well before the finalizing
right.
of the budget, if we have to go back and amend the line item or something. But
mm-hmm.
but I understand what you're saying. At one point, you had, you and I had a kind of little bit of discussion about doing something with some personnel in-house. We're not going to reflect that on the 16 budget, or is it reflected here?
It is, yes. On page, on the proposed personnel schedules.
Yeah, this one.
Yes. This is actually something that we have been talking about internally, and we feel that this is the best option. If you see the proposed personnel schedules, you see obviously you the three commissioners and then the appointed administrator. We have a vacant administrative assistant position that's in our current year 15 budget. Actually, we have two part-time positions that we have not filled within the commissioner's office. Justina has been doing a phenomenal job keeping up on all of the administrative work for the office. But we feel that we really need to increase some areas within the commissioner's office, primarily in regard to human resources. Mm-hmm. We feel that we need to have someone that can focus more attention on personnel-related functions, working with the county administrator on doing human resource coordination for grants, contracts, keeping track of independent contractors versus full-time staff. And so what we're recommending is that Justina, who's our administrative assistant too, take on the role of human resources coordinator. And in doing so, we would hire an administrative assistant too on a full-time basis. And we're able to do that under our budget.
You're happy with leaving that figure in there for the 32.8?
32.
I don't like saying people's names. The administrative assistant at full time at 32,852 is significant.
Yeah, I don't think that that's.
I mean, I don't know, so I'm just asking. I mean, that's a significant amount.
I don't think
it seems low to me.
Yeah.
Well, I apologize. It's not significant increase in salary, but what I'm saying is it's keeping at the overall operational for personnel in line.
So, the administrative assistant right now is Justina.
And she's part-time?
On a part-time basis.
So, you're proposing that she split a position? Or you're going to have two separate people?
What we would be doing is we would move Justina from doing the administrative assistant function to human resource coordinator function, continuing on a part-time basis. And then we would hire one full-time administrative assistant. We're right now we have two part-time assistant positions budgeted, but not yet filled.
Those two part-time positions, when you add them together, what's the value? Do you know?
It's in the 42,000 range, something like that. 27 and 15.
So I mean, once again, this is just on a personal note, and it's something that we don't have to do today. But certainly, I think we should do it before we send the budget along. You know, if we're going to hire an administrator at 150, which is what's in the budget today, I would think that he would want an assistant administrator which was close to the 60s. And maybe I'm wrong, I don't know, but I would like to see those, maybe take the actual dollar values that you have, combine them both, and see if we can't increase that full-time position to a little bit more money without impacting the budget too much. I mean, obviously, I know we're going to, but
you want to hire good people. You don't want to just you get
we
what
don't
you
want
pay
somebody
for.
Like Justina.
We want somebody like Justina.
Okay, she didn't even.
Yeah, she didn't even.
She didn't even
went
right over.
Yeah, obviously, she's been hanging with you a lot in the last couple of weeks, Leo. So, so this sounds. This has been discussed with you. I mean, we're kind of talking a personnel issue here.
Yeah,
with
right,
you here, so
right.
This
yeah,
is
we
kind
keep
of
it, we should be keeping
right,
those out of it.
Right.
You know,
yeah. The reasoning behind that was that, from my understanding, the county administrator would still be the human resources director, and so that person, the human resources coordinator, would be more of the administrative part, which
okay.
I already do. But I do not have time. It needs to be expanded. I do not have time to
right.
be the assistant, administrative assistant, and the human resources assistant. And there's so much more to do.
Well, you don't
we
have
do
time.
Do.
You don't have time because you don't have the hours given
right.
to you. If you had the hours given to you, are you able to work those hours? Because you're.
No, I do
because
not.
You can only work part time
right.
now. Okay, so that's
and,
all I wanted.
And the issue also is that right now, because we do not have a human resources person, payroll and my position, we kind of picked up,
mm-hmm.
and we're trying to
one
fill, but it's not enough.
Yeah,
I just think we ought to go back and look at what a value of an administrator assistant truly is.
I agree.
And come forward with that number, and let us beat you that one down a little bit.
Right.
Because unfortunately, I think you're going to be coming in you know, really high. So if you could kind of get us an idea of what that position really should pay.
Right.
And then between that and what we're savings by getting rid of the two part-times, I think that we should be looking at increasing that 32,852 to some other number. And I'd like to, you know, at least have that discussion.
Okay, and just to clarify, again, it's an administrative assistant position comparable to all the other county departments.
Right.
The administrative assistant is in the OC 4 level, and so that's why
that's why
we salaried at consistent with what it would be going in at another department level.
Okay.
All right. Well, let's have the other numbers too on top of it.
If we could call it something different then, I'll look at another slot. I mean, do you feel comfortable that you're going to get a good applicant for an administrative assistant salary at that range?
It's quite possible, yes.
Well, it's quite possible, but let's take a better look at it. And as far as the other question I have on here is the one thing that we didn't talk about was the Arts Foundation. I just want to see where did that relationship, is there any way we can look back on when that relationship was first struck and made formal? And was it done by ordinance resolution or just a commissioner's statement? I'm just wondering if we could look that up.
What I'll do is I'll put together a report and show it to you and then incorporate the language about what about Arts Foundation also moving forward with it.
Okay.
The CEDC for the $10,000 grant
right.
as well.
That would be great. Okay. And then we can revisit this. All right. Any other questions on our budget?
Just because I didn't write it down, Michael, I'm sorry to ask you again, but the two part-time positions that we basically would be vacating with this proposal that you have here, those funds are a lot over the 32 or about equal to the 32?
By any chance, do you have a copy of the 2015 budget?
I have the 2015 budget right
yeah,
here.
Yeah, I'll look right here for you.
I'm sorry, it's not under the commissioner's one, though. It's, let's see, if we go to index. Yeah, we find
it. Oh, I can find it
okay.
Really easy.
We're going to make Leo the administrative assistant. He's got this all down, so.
Stop it. I might be looking for a job, though. For those of you out there that might be hiring, call the boss, please.
I have a conflict of interest.
I just would like to say that county commissioners deserve full-time administrative assistant.
I absolutely agree.
And so,
I don't even have a desk, and you want me to get a full-time assistant.
I'm not saying necessarily you, but there's got to be a full-time
You
position.
Might get a desk if you apply for the job.
It's we have two positions. One is full time with insurance, the other one is part time non insurance. And combined they're around 58,000.
Okay.
That sounds good.
Thanks.
You're welcome.
Oh yeah, so you'll be getting rid of these two.
Yes, they would be combined.
Okay, I'm done. Thank
okay.
you.
Okay.
Yeah.
All right. So we can move on from there. So next on our agenda is a discussion on the and potential vote on the resolution regarding the standing committee of the Barnstable County Assembly of Delegates on the telecommunication and energy as adopted by the Assembly. So what their resolution states is, in order to inform the Assembly of Delegates on matters as they relate to public utilities, telecommunications, energy and energy-related matters, a standing committee shall be established and shall consist of no less than 3 members, no more than 5. Standing Committee on Telecommunication and Energy shall meet at the discretion of the chairman for the purpose of gathering information and making recommendations relevant to policy and budgetary decisions of the Assembly and the general welfare of the citizens of Barnstable County. So this is fine. We got an opinion from Bob Troy that we really didn't have to do anything about this. It's a resolution, they passed it, and they're going to have another subcommittee, which is kind of moving with the times, which I think is a good thing. We have one on, there's the environment and policy, and then there's human services, and there's a couple of others, governance, and what are the other, finance, and then there's another one. So I think this is fine, but they have to realize that it's not just, you know, Cape Light Compact and CVEC issues that they are, you know, where telecommunications, that's all, you know, regarding the RAN and the Open Cape and the regional plan, energy plan that is incorporated into the regional policy plan. So there's lots of sources of information they should look when they're pulling together like the whole picture, and other than that, I think that it's a good thing.
Madam Chairman, for the record, I would move that we support this resolution 1501.
Sure. I will second that.
Okay, just for discussion purposes, Madam Chair, I understand that this is an internal operations of the Assembly of Delegates, and by the charter, we are not required to vote on it. However, that if we do not take action, it will become a approved document in so many days.
Mm-hmm.
We have a letter from our attorney stating that, but I think it sends a message back to the Assembly. Anytime somebody wants to yet again create yet another committee and get volunteers together and people together that look at things, we should be showing them our support for it.
Mm-hmm.
So that's why I make a motion, even though I know that for the record it's not necessary to be approved. And certainly if we denied it, it would go forward anyhow because, again, it's internal affairs.
Right.
But I think I would like to send the message back to the Assembly that we support this. And I agree,
and so the motion is made. Can I have a vote?
Aye.
Aye.
Great, thank you.
So, yeah, and it's an advisory, and it also, it's an exercise for them to become better informed and understand the situation as well, so. Okay, moving right along, general budget discussion on the adopted FY 2015, the budget that we are in. Did you request this to be on the agenda?
I have requested that to be on the agenda, and I will tell you I would appreciate if it was on the agenda as almost weekly, because once again, I have concerns with our FY 15 budget.
Mm-hmm.
I have concerns with our revenue projections, and I don't think I can make really good decisions on FY 16's budget unless I can better understand our financial situation under FY 15.
Mm-hmm.
So I think it's there is a ordinance, or not an ordinance, I think it's a resolution, which has been submitted to the Assembly requesting that. I don't have it in front of me, so I'll just kind of paraphrase it, but it's basically saying that they're looking for us to level fund the county budget. And I guess there's some members of the Assembly that are also concerned. As you know, Madam Chair, there was a ordinance that was passed requiring that at any time, this is at the Assembly, I think it was sometime in December, that at any time that the budget shortfalls in revenues are not meeting expectations, that it's required that we go back and either open the budget and do some budget cuts, or somehow reassure that we're going to make the end of the year without having to transfer monies from specific reserve funds. And I just think we have not had that discussion, and I'm a little concerned about it. I wish Bob was here to maybe give us more of an update on where we currently stand in FY15's budget. We did have this revenue projection sheet handed out to us. And once again, if you just go to the big ones, which is the Registry of Deeds, you can see that, you know, we're over halfway through the year. We're only 37% collected of what we thought we were going to collect. And that kind of scares me, because as I do the numbers out, it appears that we're going to be, if we go by the budget, the way it's written, and the expenditures match the expenditures that we've voted, that we may be, yet again, coming up around $700,000 short.
Well,
and I just think that we need to have this conversation.
I agree. I think that I will support all of your, I mean, I hear everything you're saying. Bob is not here. I think that those are all valid. Just, you know, we have to remember that what we see in front of us as a snapshot isn't always the whole thing of what's being anticipated still coming in and that sort of thing. So as we get closer to the end, we'll see a better picture of where we are. I agree. I have concern, maybe not as dire as you, but I still have concern. And I have concern more about going forward the next several years and how we're going to, what we're going to try to lean down and then build up again. But some things might have to just be put on hold until we can get ourselves straight.
Well, I also did some other things that I, as you know, we have discussed and voted to bond some monies to finish out the fiscal year 2015.
Mm-hmm.
We have put aside some of the capital expenditures, and for instance, I'm just going to go to the big one, let's say the parking lot.
Mm-hmm.
However, even when you consider that that bonding, it's directly related to capital expenditures. So there's, because we're not bonding as much as we anticipated, it is in no way a direct savings because we're not doing the jobs.
Right.
So that's just kind of something that, you know, it needs to be out there.
Mm-hmm.
The other thing is that I went back on my own to fiscal year 2011. And I realized that in 2011, we had, in order to come up with a level-funded budget, we had projected bonding $1.25 million. And in fiscal 2012, in order to have a level-funded budget, we also bonded $1.28 million. In 13, the figure was 1.3 million, and in fiscal 14, the figure was 3,600,000. Now, you add all those up, that's $7,600,000 worth of bonding that should have taken place over the last 4 years, fiscal 11, 12, 13, and 14, in order for us to make the budget. It also has come to my attention that we have never budgeted, never bonded.
Never bonded.
So there's only two ways you can make up, well, three ways that you can make up this kind of shortfall. One is you don't do the projects at all, you just never spent the money, which I think is, you know,
not good.
Shows neglect, especially in our facilities.
Yeah.
The second is we had some sort of windfall in our projected revenues, which, you know, obviously you don't need the bond because you've made an exceptional amount of money,
mm-hmm.
So you don't need the bond. And the third is that you make up these differences with savings.
Right.
Either way, I'm concerned that we need to have this conversation, and we need to know, and I believe there may be some bonding issues coming forward to rectify some of this.
Mm-hmm.
And once again, I think that's going to have an impact on our FY16 budget.
I agree.
And
how we're going to pay those bonds.
How we're going to pay for those.
So now that Bob is back, and he is probably maybe not prepared for the answers to this, so I'm going to. Yeah, you can make them up for now, and then they'll just stick.
No.
So if you don't feel comfortable, then we can just put this on for either tomorrow's conversation or for next week's conversation to be a little bit more in depth.
Yep.
But Leo, why don't you just kind of go over what you just said about the last several years of you looking at these bonding issues and.
My biggest thing is really, I think, and have asked that the FY15 budget process be on our agenda almost weekly right now, because I have a concern, and I would like to be updated as things change. So that's one of the things said, you know. My concerns are that as when I go over the revenues and the projected revenues, I see a shortfall coming. And I would, and I know that you gentlemen have been working to try to recoup some of that shortfall, where it's, whether it be in a department that may not be spending what they've been budgeted to spend. Thus, we have a little bit of a plus there.
And the county administrator has been doing that.
Right, right.
Michael
has been. As you know, Bob, there was a ordinance passed at the assembly which requires that when a revenue shortfall is perceived, that we start doing this work early on, so that we're not hit in June when it's all said and done with some, oh my God, we're $700,000 short, or someone's pulling money out of some reserve account that not necessarily should be used to level fund the budget. So basically, I just want to know where we stand, what's the projected shortfall from you gentlemen, and what kind of work have you been doing to maybe put together a resolve to that shortfall, if in fact there is one.
I can start. I've met with Mark, talked with him about the potential, because the registry of deeds is where the issue, I think, lies. The other departments seem to be coming through based upon the 6-month projection, which you saw, which I think was in your packet,
yeah,
showing, you know, where we are. And some of those legitimately are lower, because you don't get the income during the first 6 months. So I understand that. Mark seems to believe that with the, and we don't, haven't analyzed that this yet, with the combination of people not spending as much as they've been allotted because of the work the county administrator has been doing, and Jack Mead's projection of maybe doing a little better than his initial reaction, will be close. But we are still looking at somewhat of a shortfall, but I can't give you an estimate of exactly what that number is yet.
Okay. I made a motion a while back, and it did not receive a second. And that motion was to suspend all non-governmental, necessary governmental spending at this point until we can get a handle around this. Now, that the motion didn't get a second. I understand that that's basically what you're, what the administrator and you were trying to do with the department heads. But in all due respect to the department heads, too, I mean, if there's not a consensus of the leadership to say, you know what, stop for a minute, and if there's some non-essential stuff, do not spend it. Once again, I can't stress enough, I think it should be coming from up here, not from the administration, because the administration can do what they can, but he can't stop Jack Mead from all of a sudden seeing that, you know, he's got a little bit extra, and I shouldn't say that. He can't stop a department head from saying, well, gee, I got this money, I might as well run down and spend it for what it was allocated for. It's not illegal, it's not wrong.
Well, but I think
they were budgeted, and they should be able to spend it.
But I believe the county administrator can do that, just like a town administrator could.
Yes.
Yeah.
Without, as the consensus seems clear that if we have a problem, you three want to make sure that we're going to be in balance before the, at the end of the year.
Right.
You know, I think if your motion had passed, we'd be concerned about what you need to define that. So there'd have to be a lot of definition.
Right.
What do you mean by that? Does that mean there's no county expenditures? Does that mean, what is your definition of, you know, not not critical,
essential,
or whatever,
yeah,
whatever the word is that you use. So I think I got the message.
I guess
I'm
just
Michael
trying to give our administrators some support from the leadership, basically, is what
so
I'm trying to do.
That's kind of my piece.
I mean, even if it was a not as strictly written motion, but something to give him some support, so when he contacts the department heads, he knows that he's got the support of the executive body behind him, that, you know, we do foresee a problem. Because right now, nobody's talking about it. There's an elephant in the room, and the only time we talk about it is, quite frankly, when I want to bring it up. So.
Well, I think it's because we do understand the situation, and we are, we feel that we have competent people at the helm, and they're right here in front of us, and they will let us know if they are going to need that decree of support. But generally speaking, an administrator is sort of the boss man, and I'm hoping everybody is doing as you ask, and let us know if they're not. And I think that everybody does want their own budgets to come out on the right side of the ledger and not to be, you know, held.
Madam Chair, Commissioners, just to reiterate what Bob said, we are concerned. We're, especially from the revenue point of view, we do believe that there's going to be a shortfall in the collection from the deeds based upon their fees. But comparably, our expenditures are going to be down. So when you look at the overall $28 million budget, it's a combination of revenue and expenditure. So we know that when the revenues are down, the expenditures have to be as well. And so we've been working with staff on that, and we feel real comfortable that at least we're moving forward correctly. As a thought, Bob and I can come back next Wednesday at your commissioner's meeting and give you a report of the 7 months. So we'll let you know what's happened in January. And we'll also give you a copy of the draft treasurer's report, which not only looks at a combination of the revenue and expenditure, but it looks at all the account funds that we have and the status of those. So that'll give you what I would call, instead of a 75% shot at the overall finances, it'll give you a closer picture of the 100%.
Okay.
So we would like to do that, and we feel that if it's acceptable to you, we could come back at next Wednesday's meeting and give you a more comprehensive update.
You know, the only thing I would add to that is that you mentioned that there's maybe some expenditures down, and if they're in the magnitude of fairly large figures, I'm not sure why we're not addressing that in 16's budget then, because if some departments are actually having savings of $250,000, then why is that not reflected in 16's budget to not be in there? I mean, it sounds to me it's been a, you know, oh yeah, we'll just level funding knowing that we're 200,000 over or whatever. I just throw figures out there. So once again, help me move forward to 2016's budget. I think those figures might help me a little bit too, because I might be the one making a motion to cut those budgets next year so that we don't have that, I don't want to say padded, but extra money sitting in the expense account that it hasn't, especially if we can show that in the past couple of years it hasn't been expended. I mean, maybe it's changing our budget process a little bit from level funding to actual funding. I know there's some kind of a legal term for that, but
yeah,
because there might be some savings there that we could carry on to 2016. Of course, it's going to make us in a predicament at the end of 2016 when, if we come up with a shortfall, we're not going to have that that cushion, if you will. But once again, if we're talking about budgeting, I think all this information I think is prudent and should be out there.
Okay. So a week from tomorrow,
yes,
we will hear that, and Pat will be here as well for that, so that would be a better time to have that conversation. Is that fine with you?
Yep. The only other thing I talked to Bob very briefly is I went back to 2011 and researched in the budgets, the approved budgets, and 11, 12, 13, and 14, just those years specifically, and there was bond issue revenues addressed in those budgets. And I'm wondering where we are on that. And
I mean, if it did it.
Do you want to put that off for next week too? Fine, but
no,
we'd like to have that addressed and at least.
Well, in general terms, the there was no bonding done in those years that I'm aware of. What the county administrator and I are working on now is to do FY15, whatever is finally agreed to by this board as far as facilities go, because the facilities have been held by the county administrator, and we may not have to borrow all that. That's certainly, he'll make a recommendation to you.
Because we're not doing the work, though.
Right. Right. The county administrator has held that,
right,
at least on facilities.
Right.
The IT has been done. The planimetrics needs to be done. That's critical,
that
I believe.
Critical.
So we at least borrow that and then some other things. But I think what you're referring to are the prior years.
Right, yes.
Those, that needs to be addressed. I believe that a plan, which I probably am going to recommend, is do over 3 years to to bond those items.
And that has.
To do the actual bond.
That's gonna actually have to be reflected in the FY16's budget, the portion that you wanna do that year.
Yes. Yep. Mm-hmm.
So we should be anticipating that someone's gonna be coming forth from your department.
Yes. Yes.
With a request to bond X amount of dollars and.
Right.
It's to, I don't, we'll use the wrong.
It's really to cover those expenditures that have already been made. When Mark and I talked about it, he said in prior years, what they would do is at the end of the year, there'd be a transfer from the commissioners of excess funding to pay for some of the capital items, but that has not happened in the past several years because you haven't had any surplus. So we do need to, I believe, borrow. It's the best time because the rates are not gonna get any lower.
Right.
So I believe we need to get that started.
When I was on the assembly, I voted last year to on the fiscal 15's budget. And part of my vote was predecessed by the comment from our then finance director that we had a $2.7 million cash
reserve.
And my argument at the assembly was, you know, at a $28 million budget and we have $2.7
mm-hmm.
million in reserves, we're sitting okay. So I made certain decisions at that time.
10% is,
yeah.
is really
Can
what
Can you tell us what where we're going to be at with...
Okay, we can ask.
All reserves that are used and open to the
mm-hmm.
general county government. So basically, I don't. If you want to do a separate line item for like the dredge, which is fine, but that's a revolving fund or a designated enterprise fund. So that's not available to the...
No, it is not.
Right. So I'm looking for just the available to county funds. Reserve dollar values.
Because you do have a lot of restricted funds here,
mm-hmm.
from what I'm seeing. So
we have a lot of restricted accounts, but are there a lot of funds in those restricted
right.
accounts?
And there may be, but you may not have access
right.
to them.
Right.
I think that's part of even the audit.
It is.
Yeah.
So
yeah.
we probably just extracted
yeah.
from
yeah.
that.
I haven't got a copy of the audit yet, so I don't
it's
think.
It's not finalized.
This year is not completed.
Okay,
last
that's why.
Year's,
yes. Yeah.
Okay, we can do that.
Yeah. Good.
And do we have an extra copy of that audit from last year?
Sure.
We
yeah,
do.
Yeah.
Oh,
I'd
sure.
like to grab one before we go,
mm-hmm.
only it's for my own personal.
Mm-hmm. Sure.
So,
reserves, okay.
And I think that's it. Is there any...
Thank you guys for coming in.
Thank
Appreciate
you.
It.
No.
All right, so is there anybody who would like to...
I
see members of the public before we wrap this up.
Madam Chair, gentlemen
yes.
from Dennis. Assembly of Delegates. Have you guys done any more research into the possible financial repercussions from the fire training academies?
That is going to be discussed tomorrow.
Tomorrow's meeting?
Yes, it's on tomorrow's agenda.
So there has been some movement there?
Well, there's been some discussion, and I'd like it to be a little bit more detailed. I think that I've had a discussion on it, and it's time that... there's information that has to be shared. It wasn't all complete when I was being made aware of it. I think it will be a little bit more complete tomorrow, and it will be an opportunity for the other commissioners to hear where we are with that situation.
Who is doing that research?
Tom Camberry over at
Cape Cod Commission
with, I think, Dave Santos over at Barnstable, DPW Santos.
Oh, yes. Yes.
Dave or Dan?
Dan.
Dan Santos.
So one of those people may be at the meeting tomorrow.
I think both will be there.
Yes.
So you're welcome to come.
Thank you.
Okay. Elenita? No? Just visiting?
Yep.
Okay.
Motion to adjourn?
Yes. Second. All in favor?
Aye.
Thank you very much.